At 11 a.m. on the 11th of November 2018, one of the world's most famous bells, Big Ben, rang across an unusually still and silent central London. The chimes could be heard clearly in Whitehall and at the Cenotaph, where I was fortunate enough to be standing, along with many thousands of others, to mark the centenary for the ending of the First World War. The First World War, the Great War, or named by some optimistically at the time as the War to End All Wars, has slipped into history proper as the last surviving veterans of that conflict leave us behind. A history in which, sadly, other subsequent conflicts have cemented themselves into the public consciousness, perhaps viewed as more important or even more relevant to our modern lives. After all, the world is a very different place now. But the world which went to war in 1914 was not the world which, 4 years later, staggered, shell-shocked, exhausted, bloodied from the carnage of trench warfare. A stunned world, in which millions of young men lay dead as a result of new methods of fighting. A damaged world, in which millions more men returned home suffering from truly horrific injuries, both mental and physical. A world which saw the collapse of entire empires and the fall of centuries-old institutions. At battles such as Vimy Ridge and Gallipoli, a new rise of patriotism for Canada, Australia, New Zealand, a nationhood born in the tests and struggles of war. Britain, as part of the victorious Allies, saw an explosion of celebration and sheer relief that the war was finally over, and that soon her heroes would be returning to her. Yet behind the flag waving and cheering, the country was counting the cost. Seemingly in every town and village across the land, a loved one would not be returning. The grim trickle of information the public previously received about the war was starting to turn into a flood, as men returned and experiences were shared. The naive assumptions of a quick war and it will all be over by Christmas had long and quietly been dropped. But that was not generally acknowledged just how dangerously close to defeat Britain had been. Standing near the Cenotaph, I was only a few feet away from the British establishment. The Prime Minister at the time, Theresa May, the Leader of the Opposition, Jeremy Corbyn, both Princes William and Harry, amongst other dignitaries. As I watched the Prime Minister, I wondered if she appreciated the parallels of Britain's current challenge with Europe, Brexit, and if naive misunderstandings from our own trickle of information of the impending international confrontations had set this heading. Of course, these negotiations won't, at least hopefully, result in trenches, gas attacks and barbed wire, but this Prime Minister was standing not far away from where another Prime Minister had stood, with the weight of history rested upon their next actions. In this series, I will look at the First World War and its impact on the country, the events and decisions that led to the war into the carnage of a mechanised total war that shook the old order, indeed humanity itself, to the very core. And the consequences of that war that, depressingly, saw the world collapse into another, even larger conflict only 2 decades later.